Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu lehadlik necha. Baruch ata Eloheinu melech haolam she'asa nisim la'avotenu bayamim ahem bazman hazeh. Tikon betefilati vesham toda mezabera.
Back in 1991, I lit Chanukah candles with Mikhail Gorbachev, who had, until earlier that year, been president of the Soviet Union. For 70 years, the practice of Judaism had been effectively banned in communist Russia. It was one of the two great assaults on our people and faith in the 20th century. The Germans sought to kill Jews. The Russians tried to kill Judaism. Under Stalin, the assault became brutal. Then in 1967, after Israel's victory in the Six-Day War, many Soviet Jews sought to leave Russia and go to Israel. And not only was permission refused, but often the Jews concerned lost their jobs and were imprisoned. Around the world, Jews campaigned for the prisoners, refuseniks as they were called, to be released and allowed to leave. Eventually, Mikhail Gorbachev realized that the whole Soviet system was unworkable. Communism had brought not freedom and equality, but repression, a police state, and a new hierarchy of power. In the end, it collapsed, and Jews regained the freedom to practice Judaism and to go to Israel. That day in 1991, after we'd lit candles together, Mr. Gorbachev asked me through his interpreter what we'd just done. I told him that 22 centuries ago, in Israel, the public practice of Judaism had been banned and Jews fought for and won their freedom. And the lights of Chanukah were the symbol of that victory. And I continued, 70 years ago, Jews suffered the same loss of freedom in Russia. And you, Mr. Gorbachev, have now helped them to regain it. So you, too, have become part of the Chanukah story. And as the translator translated my reply into Russian, Mikhail Gorbachev blushed. The Chanukah story still lives, still inspires, telling us, not just us, but the world, that though tyranny exists, freedom, with God's help, will always win the final battle. Happy Chanukah. Chanukah Sameach.
Chanukah light feels so right. It's my everyone. My name is Shulie Mishkin, and on this gorgeous morning, we are standing here on top of Nebi Samuel, what the Crusaders called Mon Joie, the mountain of my happiness. Right? Why were they so happy? Because they're looking out toward Jerusalem. And that's what we're going to talk about here. What is this place? So Nebi Samuel, a lot of you may be familiar with this, is often called the grave of Samuel the prophet, Kever Shmuel Hanavi, which means that this would be Ramah, right? Ramah is Shmuel's hometown. It's where he's buried. But already in the 1930s, and again now with recent excavations, we think it's probably not Ramah, but it's a place called Mitzpah. Now, if you know Hebrew, you know the word Mitzpah, Tatzpit, like Har HaTzofim, means an outlook, a lookout to something. First of all, we are very high up. We are 900 meters above sea level. We have an incredible view of Jerusalem right in front of us, and that's why the Crusaders called this the Mountain of Joy, because as they're coming, this is their first view of Jerusalem, which is their goal, this is their destination, okay? And it's a place where you are looking out towards Jerusalem, so it makes a lot of sense that this would be Mitzpah. Now, why is Mitzpah an exciting place? You'd say it's not the place where Shmuel HaNavi is buried. What's so special about it? It's actually very special. We hear in Tanakh, in the Bible, about a lot of things happening at Mitzpah. The children of Israel gather here in the book of Judges to prepare themselves to go out to war. Samuel the prophet gathers everybody here a few times. Once to crown the first king of Israel, King Saul, happens in Mitzpah. And another time, take a look in Tanakh, right? In Shmuel Aleph, the first book of Samuel, in the 7th chapter, Vayomer Shmuel kibtzu et kol Yisrael ha-mitzpata va-apalel ba'adchem el Hashem. Samuel said, assemble all Israel at Mitzpah, and I will pray to the Lord for you. Mitzpah is a place where you come together to pray, to repent, to call out to God, to go out to war. It's a very significant site. Let's fast forward to our story of Chanukah. The first battle has already taken place. Judah the Maccabee and his forces have been successful against the Greeks in the first battle, but the Greeks have come back more powerful than ever. And Judah the Maccabee takes a page from the Bible and says, let's gather here like our ancestors did. He's very aware of what Am Yisrael did in the past. Let's go back to this historic place and let us pray to Hashem for salvation here in this place. And in the first book of Maccabees, what do we have? The Israelites assembled themselves together and came to Mitzpah over against Jerusalem. For Mitzpah was the place where they prayed before in Israel. And they fasted and put on sackcloth and cast ashes upon their head and rent their clothes. They did tshuva. They did all the things that are connected to tshuva. And they called out with a loud voice and said, your sanctuary is trodden and profane. The heathen are assembled there. And then Judah organized the people to go out to battle. Mitzpah is the place of prayer, of repentance. And from here, Yehudah HaMakkabi takes his forces to fight in the distinctive, important battle at Emmaus to the west of us. Okay, we are standing inside a house. You can really see that it's a house. And this house is exciting for two reasons, okay? This house dates back to early Second Temple period times, what we call Hellenistic times, 4th, 3rd, 2nd century before the Common Era, before our story of Hanukkah, before Judah the Maccabee. And this house was discovered about 30 years ago, and it's the reason why we know that we are standing in a biblical era site. What does that mean? Right? The Crusaders who came here 1,000 years ago built so massively and quarried so massively that they destroyed a lot of the site, and nobody had found any evidence that this is really a biblical period site. But about 30 years ago, the Israel Antiquities Authority came here and started to excavate this part of the site that the Crusaders hadn't touched. And suddenly, what did they discover? An entire housing area that goes back to early Second Temple period times, okay? Jewish housing near Jerusalem, early Second Temple period. But in the fill, in the foundations of the houses, they found pottery and other artifacts that go back to biblical times. So we know that this is a biblical site. So that's one thing that's super exciting about this place. The other thing is that this is the last layer from Second Temple times, meaning the Hasmonean Army Base, after they conquered Jerusalem, They don't build another neighborhood on top of this neighborhood. They don't move in here. Why not? Because this is mitzpah. Mitzpah means I am tzofeh. I am looking towards Jerusalem. I'm yearning for Jerusalem. But by the time the Hasmonaim conquer Jerusalem, they don't need to build anything else here in mitzpah because they no longer need to be tzofeh to Jerusalem, to be looking at Jerusalem in the distance. They're established in Jerusalem itself. So this site becomes insignificant for a very long time afterwards.
שלום וברכה, הרב זקס שנפטר רק עכשיו, אמר באחת השיחות שלו שיש משהו מיוחד בתקופה הזאת שלא היה אף פעם בהיסטוריה. היו זמנים בהיסטוריה שהייתה לנו מדינה יהודית. היו זמנים בהיסטוריה שבגלות לעם ישראל הייתה אוטונומיה, שעם ישראל יכול היה לחיות בחופש, בשוויון. אף פעם לא היה לנו את שני הדברים ביחד. רק עכשיו יש לנו גם מדינת ישראל וגם חופש מיוחד ליהודים בחוץ לארץ. דבר מדהים. ילד אחד שאל אותי, הרב, אתה יכול להוכיח שיש אלוקים? הוא אומר, הרב, אין לי הרבה זמן, אז שלא יהיה ארוך, ככה שתי דקות. אמרתי לו, תראה, אם היית שואל אותי לפני 100 שנה, לא יכולתי לתת לך תשובה של שתי דקות. היום אין לי שום בעיה לתת לך תשובה של שתי דקות. שאל אותי, אז מה התשובה? אמרתי לו, אף פעם בהיסטוריה לא היה דבר כזה שזרקו עם מארצו, והוא חזר. והוא חזר אחרי 2,000 שנה להיות היום במדינת ישראל. לראות לא רק שחזרנו, יש לנו מדינה מדהימה, מצליחה ברוך השם. יש לנו את צבא ההגנה לישראל. לא יאומן, אנחנו רואים את דברי התורה ודברי הנביאים מתגשמים לנגד עינינו. לא רק שאנחנו יודעים שיש אלוקים, אנחנו יודעים שהשם אוהב עמו ישראל, הקדוש ברוך הוא אוהב אותנו, נמצא איתנו. לא יאומן. זה נכון, ברוך השם, שיש משהו מיוחד, כמו שאמר הרב זקס, שיהודים גם בחוץ לארץ יכולים להיות חופשיים. דבר מדהים. אתם יודעים מה זה אומר לנו? שליהודים יש היום עוד שכר כשהם עולים לארץ. כי בחוץ לארץ טוב, הם חופשיים. עולים לארץ, הם עולים לא בגלל רדיפות, לא בגלל שקשה להם, להפך אולי טוב להם. עולים לארץ כי מבינים שהמקום הכי מדהים ליהודי זה בארץ, שזאת השליחות שלנו, זאת הקדושה של הארץ. אז אנחנו שמחים מאוד בכל הדברים שהיהודים עושים בגלות, ויש יהודים שהם שליחים גדולים ועושים דברים מדהימים, ובנסיעות שלי לחוץ לארץ אני מתרגש לראות איך יהודים בחוץ לארץ פועלים כל הזמן למען ארץ ישראל. אז אנחנו רוצים להודות גם לכל היהודים שפועלים למען ארץ ישראל ומדינת ישראל בגלות, ובעזרת השם שבזמן הנכון והטוב תוכלו להיות בארץ הקודש, להגיע לארץ הקודש, והדבר הכי חשוב, שהמבט הזה על ארץ ישראל, המבט הזה על הנס הגדול שהקדוש ברוך הוא עשה לנו, יסביר לנו כל הזמן, לא רק שאנחנו מאמינים בקדוש ברוך הוא, אנחנו יודעים, השם אוהב עמו ישראל, אוהב אותנו, נמצא איתנו, ובעזרת השם שנזכה יחד להמשיך לראות בשלבי הגאולה הבאים. להתראות.
Freedom. I love freedom. I was arrested with my friends in the airport trying to escape illegally from Soviet Union many years ago. And I felt excited and privileged, for it was an escape not only to freedom, to a Jewish state, trying to being Jewish. So, when I was in prison, I considered myself a war prisoner, and I behaved as a proud Jew, trying to keep all the mitzvahs, keeping Shabbos, and for this I was punished. But I felt good about that. And I think it is the real meaning of Ben Horin, a man that is doing what he believes is true, is not afraid of anything. Still, being in a Russian jail, you can't consider yourself altogether free. When after 11 years in prison, I was released and arrived to Eretz Israel, the next day I went to learn in the yeshiva of Rav Lichtenstein. I drafted in Israel Army and I married a beautiful girl. So I felt I am really free, a free man in Jewish country studying Torah. But then I understood something else. Indeed, our state is strong and independent, militarily, economically, maybe politically, but not spiritually. Still we depend on many, many strange ideologies and values. And my understanding now is that I cannot be free until my nation is not really free. I am not alone. I am everything. My nation, my state, my belief. So we are on a long way to real freedom in our free country. And really be free. Jewish, it means to me to be free.